Hey chess lovers, welcome back to the Chessyard. This is dhairyabagga and today I'll be showing you one of the interesting chess games that I played 4 weeks back. I was playing here as white and I started off with d3 just trying to see what my opponent does here. Opponent plays d5 and now I go for d4 trying to accomplish the same which I could have done in the first move itself. And then opponent plays e6. I go with a bishop to f4 trying to convert this into a London system setup. Opponent plays knight f6. I went with e3. Standard moves there, trying to consolidate the center. Opponent plays bishop e7, preparing to castle now. And I went with bishop to e2 with the idea of pushing the h pawn to h4 and then h5. Opponent drops the other knight onto d7. And I start pushing the h pawn to h4. Opponent plays a6, trying to prevent a bishop to b5, which was anyway unlikely, because I had already developed my bishop onto e2. And then I went with h5, opponent plays c5, trying to expand from the queen side. And I keep pushing my pawn to h6 now, finally. I haven't developed minor pieces yet, but I'm just pushing away the corner pawn, which is generally not the right approach. But since my opponent hasn't castled, I wanted him to make some moves and decide what he wants to do. So opponent dash straight here, I take back with the bishop. Now it's quite evident that the opponent cannot castle on the queen on the king side. Here opponent takes the center pawn, which I then take back with the e pawn, making sure that I can then play a c3 and will have connected pawn chain at least here. And then I can castle queen side and make use of these pawns to attack my opponent on the king side. Opponent plays a knight to e4, trying to develop the bishop, maybe exchange the dark square bishops here. I went with c3, trying to play solid. Bishop comes to h4 now, trying to attack the f2 pawn there. And I cannot take with my rook because queen is defending that. So that's not possible. I went with g3, trying to kick the bishop backwards. Bishop goes back to f6. And here comes a knight to d2, trying to exchange the knights because you want to eliminate pressure. And this knight is pressurizing a lot of stuff here already in the center. So I want to take it off from here so that there's no threats at all. And if you see, after I place my knight onto d2, I'm ahead in the evaluation bar as well by 2 points. Now this is decent enough of advantage already in the middle game. If you like this video already by now, do subscribe to the channel, please. And press on the bell icon as well so that you don't miss out on any of the videos that I'm posting up daily without a miss. After knight d2, opponent goes with queen b6. And here I place my queen onto c2, defending the pawn on b2. Opponent plays rook to g8. Doesn't do much there, that rook on the b5. And I took on the knight, trying to exchange. Opponent does take. And now I castle on the queen side and pretty decent here after castling. Opponent pushes the pawn forward to e3, which I can trade, but I thought, let me just have a pawn first. So I took on h7. Opponent tries to attack my queen. Now queen comes back. Opponent can take another pawn here, but doesn't matter because then I'll develop the knight with tempo again, trying to take control of the central squares. And once I go with knight on to e5 and some trade happens, what happens is that my center file would be opened, which the rook is already controlling. So it's nice for me. After then, opponent played queen to a5, trying to attack the pawn on a2. And I defend that by moving king to b1. Opponent goes knight to b6, trying to get his knight active, maybe attack from a3 and then put the queen back, trying to have a checkmate onto b2 is one of the ideas. I got my bishop back, trying to exchange rooks off the board. Also, then I can grab another pawn if required. Opponent doesn't take the rook and gets the knight onto d5, which was kind of strange. Putting it on d5 doesn't do much except for attacking my bishop. And that's not even a problem because it's defended with the queen. I take on the rook, opponent takes back with the bishop, and I take the pawn as well with my bishop onto f2. And now bishop back to f6, preventing a move like rook h1 and then going for the check from h8. I went with knight e5, therefore, trying to put my knight on a more controlling square. Opponent doesn't take and goes with queen b6. The same idea of taking a free pawn. And that would be a fork as well, because I cannot take because of the pin from the queen. But here I played bishop to e1. A small move which defends the pawn, which makes use of my piece, which was not doing much on f2. And I improved the position of my bishop. It's a good thing with bishops is that whenever you get them back, they control more squares. So it's amazing that how a bishop is now controlling more squares. Otherwise, it was controlling lesser squares here. So it's always good when you get your bishop backwards. It controls the knight movements as well, generally. And this one was amazing because now opponent cannot come into my zone here at all. Then opponent had no other choice but to start pushing the A pawn, trying to create something out of the A file, then maybe get the rook lift done, and then. But it's too slow actually in the game, because now I go with a bishop to c4, attacking the knight. Because once I now take, opponent will have to take back, of course. You don't want to give free pieces. And then suddenly the file towards the queen is the king is also open. My queen is in the center. And opponent saw that coming, so places knight to e7, trying to run away from there. And here comes queen to f4, hitting the bishop. Now I'm asking this bishop to either move, and if you just move away backwards, what happens is you lose on the f7, and then the queen, maybe the checkmate is very nearby around the corner. And if you just go back on to h8, then again, I have, first of all, I can take is the simplest option, or I can then improve my position of the bishop, get my rook active as well, and then your bishop is kind of trapped and will eventually have to trade. So it's more of a forced trade, which opponent had to do. And once my opponent does take, here I take back with the pawn. Computer suggests you can take with the queen, but I thought of taking with the pawn so that I can make use of the open D file as well. Opponent goes a knight to g6, trying to tank the queen. And now queen to g5. Again, a very small move, not doing much, not pushing beyond where I can. So just placing the queen, defending the pawn, and threatening a move like checkmate once the queen moves from here. So I have that idea in the mind already that where I want to attack the opponent, because of the bad development by the opponent already. So just slightly maneuvering my queen to g5. Opponent plays pawn forward to a4. And here comes a rook to d6. This pawn is not doing me any harm. At my best, what the opponent can do is push it once more. And then I can simply play b3. It doesn't do me any trouble. So I'm completely okay with it. So I went with a rook to d6, hitting the queen. And have improved the position of my rook again as well. So here the best move is queen to c7. And then I have to move my bishop away from here. But what opponent does instead in the game is move the queen to g1, trying to attack the bishop. But my opponent forgot that the opponent never developed the light square bishop in the game in the first place. Here comes the final move, checkmate from queen d8. So development in a game is very important. Making subtle moves, which, for example, the bishop to e1, which consolidates your position further. And then finding the ideas of checkmating patterns, trying to exploit the weaknesses in the opponent structure is all you have to look in a chess game. My opponent doesn't complete his development ever in this game in 31 moves, and that's why I got punished. So I hope that's a good lesson, and we all can improve our games from this one. I hope you like the video. Do let me know your feedback. Keep watching and sharing. Do subscribe to the channel if you haven't already by now. And I shall see you tomorrow with some instructive and interesting content again, as always. Thanks for your time. Take care. Bye-bye.